Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar, hosted by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. Thank you for taking time out of your day to join us for learning to make better personal and professional decisions with Knight Campbell. I'm Allie Heal, the Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I'll be facilitating today's session. As a reminder, you may use the questions section of your GoToWebinar control panel on the right-hand side to submit your questions throughout the session or to let me know if you have any technical issues. You'll also use this question section to participate in any chat questions throughout the session. Now, on to our presenter. Father, outdoor guide, executive coach, and leader, Knight Campbell is passionate about the power of outdoor adventure to transform the business leadership world. After graduating from the Naval Academy in 2006, Knight led sailors in the Navy for over 16 years and 3 deployments as a helicopter pilot. He earned master's degrees in leadership at the University of Maryland and the Naval War College before teaching leadership back at the Naval Academy. He earned his executive coaching certificate at Georgetown University in 2017 and an executive leadership certificate from Cornell in 2020. Knight now pairs leadership coaching with challenging outdoor adventures to create sustainable breakthroughs for business leaders and teams. As the founder of Karen Leadership Strategies, he creates a powerful community for leaders by merging shared outdoor adventures, executive coaching, and an MBA-level leadership curriculum. When he isn't helping leaders elevate, you can find Knight climbing mountains with his wife or exploring the wild with his 2 young daughters. Without further ado, I'm pleased to turn things over to Knight.
Thank you so much, Allie. I'm excited to be here. I'm particularly excited to be talking about this topic with you all. I was reflecting this morning. This is the first keynote topic that I presented on maybe 10 years ago, and I've been thinking about it ever since. It's pretty integral to guiding and being in the outdoors and to running a business and to just life in general. So I appreciate you all being here. I think you can expect some questions today, and if you can put chat answers into the questions panel, Allie can read out the answers. That'll really help me see where we're going and make sure that it's tailored to hopefully what you're looking for. I want to start out with a little bit of a story here, mostly because the pictures are beautiful, but also because it really illustrates decision-making gone right. So a couple of years ago, some of my guides and partners and I went to Dragontail Peak and Serpentine Arete, and it's as cool as it sounds up in the Pacific Northwest. And we climbed this almost 2,000 foot face of granite. It was amazing. It was a fun, challenging day, but it took longer than we expected it to. And we got to the top right around sunset, and it was gorgeous. And it wasn't that big of a deal. It was a hike back down the backside of the pass, Asgard Pass, if you're familiar. And we had a good plan. So we went around the back of the pass, and we got to where you see in the middle picture here, this snowfield that we did not expect. I'd been up there the year before and it was kind of soft snow. You could just kind of walk through it. We didn't have the right tools, and we found right where those 3 people are standing, blue ice. Now, blue ice is hard, it's slippery, and it's frankly super dangerous, especially if you're looking at a 1,000+ foot slide down to a boulder field at the bottom. And we had a really hard decision to make. We were tired, cold, hungry, looking at a long night out in the mountains. Our expectations had radically shifted from a nice little walk down the pass to this huge problem. And we had some really new mountaineers. I had a lot of experience. One other guide had a lot of experience, and the other 2 had never really done anything in the Alpine. And we had to really gather a lot of information, try to find some good options, talk through those options, and talk about our human factors. We all wanted to get off the mountain. We'd been going since like 2, 3 a.m. that morning. We didn't want to be out there for another 12 hours. And we wanted to be safe. And ultimately we decided to rappel this long, terrible, dirty ditch between the glacier and the rock that you see on the far right picture. And it was not a fun experience at all. And we finished at like 10 a.m. the next day. But looking back, we did everything right in terms of decision making. And I would say that's not super common. We're not actually that good at making decisions. These are pictures from Catalina, where we often take corporate teams and groups of leaders out. And there's this amazing experience. It's one of my favorite things that we do, where we backpack across the island. We camp in this amazing cove with the Pacific Ocean in front of us, watching sunset. And to get back, you can either take this narrow, beautiful ridge that's pretty hard physically, or you can take a slightly longer, less elevation gain, and arguably not as beautiful road. And I kind of set the decision up that way. We can take this incredible experience, hard ridge with amazing 360 views, or we can take this road, and it's kind of pretty, and it's a little bit longer, but much easier, and probably will take a little less time. And I have not found a group yet in which there weren't a couple people like, no matter what, we're taking the hard ridge. I paid a bunch of money to come out here. I want to see this beautiful views and challenge myself. And a couple of people are like, no, I challenged myself yesterday. And if there's an easier option, that's the right thing to do for this group. We have to take care of ourselves. And I do something very similar to what we're talking about today. I give them a lot of tools. I talk through different ways to make decisions. And I often say, as a group, you need to decide how you're going to make the decision. Is it going to be voting? Is it going to be consensus? Or is someone going to be the leader, perhaps even myself or one of my co-guides? And we're going to take consultation and then make the decision for the group. And I laugh because every time the group's like, great, got all those tips, got the direction, understand that we should decide how to make the decision. Let me tell you how I feel about it. I don't want to do it. I want to do it. It's too hard. It's not too hard. We got to. And they start just throwing all of their feelings and what they want out into the middle to see what happens right after we give them this lesson. So it's frankly really hard to make good decisions. Like I say, I've been thinking about decisions for a long time. It's a big part of my job to make good decisions and manage risk. And it's just a part of living to make good decisions. And I came across this book, and it kind of makes you take a step back and think. I highly recommend it. I haven't been persuaded that there's no free will, but that's Robert Sapolsky's argument, that there's no free will, that we are essentially buffeted by our genetics, by our circumstances, by advertising, and all of the nudges around us into a path that we could not change. We are the sort of person that does X. And that's a little disheartening to me, but honestly, that's typically how my day goes. I'm buffeted by the roads closed, so I just go the other way. I don't make a decision. I don't make a decision to put my seatbelt on. I don't make a decision to correct my daughters in one way or another. I'm not being intentional. I'm typically either lucky or not lucky. So today I want to walk through decision making, think critically about what it is, what it isn't, when we can make better decisions, give you some tools that hopefully are useful. Maybe you pick one or three or whatever, probably not all eight, that's not realistic, that resonate with you that you'd like to use. And then ultimately, you're not going to use a fancy decision-making framework for most decisions. Maybe you're in finance and you have something like that, but you're not going to use that for day-to-day life or smaller decisions. Often you're lucky if you even realize that you're making a decision. So my hope is that through this presentation, you can take home three questions, just three. You can put them on a sticky on your desk, put them on a sticky at home on your refrigerator. And when a decision comes up, you start to build that skill of saying, oh, this is a decision. Let me just ask my three questions really quickly. And that will at least cue you into, I need a more robust decision-making framework. Or almost all of the time, those three questions will help you make better decisions. So I promise a little bit of asking you all questions. I'm curious how you define decision-making. And I'll share Annie Duke. I really like her work. She's been fundamental in my understanding of how to make better decisions in an intentional way. And you'll get resources in the email after this with some links to different books that she's written and a podcast with her. But she says, and I think this really resonates with me, decision making is like walking. We've been doing it since we were 1 or 2 years old, we assume that we're really good at it, and we don't really think about how well we walk. Now, could we walk better? Probably, but we don't take the time to think about it. So I'm curious from you all, and I'm pretty patient. I'll wait until, you know, 1 or 2 people throw a definition into the questions panel. Curious from you all, how do you define decision?
I'm happy to read them out. One person wrote in, choosing to do one thing over another.
Yeah, that's great. There's size is to cut. So you're cutting one thing away or cutting other options away. I've been blown away by how useful the dictionary is often in these more complex topics. And the Oxford Dictionary defines decision as a conclusion or resolution reached after consideration. Two things I think are really interesting about this definition. One, I often think a decision is about action. I'm choosing one action or another. I'm choosing to do something or not to do something, to eat something or to eat something else. But it's also a conclusion. It's deciding what you believe. It's deciding how you want to show up in the world and what's important to you. And then the other one is after consideration. I hope, if nothing else, you take away from this that often we're not considering our decisions, our options, and the information in a critical and rigorous manner. So a decision by the dictionary is, it requires some sort of consideration and then a process of winnowing away other options. Why does it matter, do you all think? And I'll give you a minute to throw in the chat your thoughts, but why are you here? What's important about making good decisions?
And while folks are thinking of that, I will just throw out 2 other definitions that came through: choice for a desired outcome, or a choice I can live with within a list of constraints.
Yeah, constraints is a great point. Why does this matter?
I'll read the 2 that came in for right now: safety and well-being. And then when you've made bad decisions, it's helpful to rethink your process.
Yeah, awesome. I love that. Being able to refine that process is something that Annie Duke has helped me to see, and I think I've gotten better at, and definitely not perfect at. I still remember, like I mentioned, this was the first topic I did a keynote speaking engagement on. I was super excited and nervous, and I went to yoga that morning, and the yoga instructor said, Aristotle said that you are the sum of your decisions. How you show up on the mat today is the sum of your decisions. Decision making is really fundamental to who you are. And if you think about it, really, every little decision you make and big decision you make when you decide to get married or take a job or not take a job or go to a certain school and not other schools, every time you cut away those other options, you more firmly entrench yourself in who you are. It defines you. Your decisions allocate your resources. Like you said, there are these constraints, and you decide among those constraints how to use your limited time, money, and energy. They eliminate different options. They determine your future, really, in a lot of ways, and not perhaps in a no free will way, as in determined, but they determine a lot. So pretty important and really hard. I'm curious from you all to chat in, what's a hard decision that you maybe have coming up or have made recently? And I'll share. My wife really wants a third child, and I am good with 2. 2 is plenty for me. And that's a hard decision, and it's embroiled in emotions and all of these, our identity and what we want for the future. It's a big one, and it's important in my mind to think through these frameworks to help us make a good decision. So I'm curious from you, from a couple of people, what's a decision you have coming up?
First one that came in was pivoting my career. Picking the right next jobs seems like maybe a common theme.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. So figuring out where to go next, should your life trajectory look like? Down to like, what should you have for dinner? Or should you watch this movie or that movie? Decision-making is really tough. And I'm not going to read through all of these. You know, there's a lot of competing interests. We have a lot of emotions that get around our decisions, and we can use those artfully or not. We're often afraid of what might happen if we do or don't make a decision. But the bottom line here is, if you had all the information, if you had two options and you knew exactly how each one would play out, decision-making maybe wouldn't even be decision-making. It would be easy. You would just pick the one that worked the best. Life's much more complex than that. And so we need to have tools, frameworks, approaches to help us navigate that. Here's what I think most of us think that decision-making looks like. We have a hard decision, we start doing waterfall diagrams, we have a Gantt chart, we do our pros and cons lists, and we weight everything accurately to make sure that we're making a smart decision. We have our SWOT analysis. We have all these tools out there. You can Google decision-making and find 100 different tools. And I'm sad to say that this is what decision-making actually looks like. I found this beautiful lake on BLM land, so anyone can camp there. No one was there. There's this little postage stamp of perfect camping land right on the lake. And I thought, wow, I'm going to drive down this hill and set up camp, and it's going to be awesome. And I get to the lip of that hill and kind of nose my car over, and I hear, and I'm like, oh no, it was a bad decision to drive down there, I guess. So I throw it in reverse to back up, and my tires just spin out. It's too steep. I'm stuck there. And so I pull out my SWOT and out. Nope, that's not at all what I do. I just put it back in first gear and gun it. And I got down. But then my car broke down and we were stuck there for 2 days, which was okay because we had camping gear and food. But it shows kind of how my decision-making frameworks work. If I don't have those three questions at the tip of my tongue, if I can't understand that or be aware that a decision is at hand and not use those tools, like I just get broken down at the bottom of a hill on a lake, which arguably was great, but it could have been really bad. So I want to offer this sort of framework. There are lots of different things that impact your decisions. I think things that are missing here on this framework are time. Sometimes we have to make a really fast decision, like traffic builds up and you got to decide, do I go left or right, take the longer route with less traffic or sit in traffic? You got to make that decision in like 2 seconds because that's the way that life is. And then other decisions like, should I pivot in my career or get a new job? You can really apply some frameworks to it and think through intentionally. But this breaks down kind of how we make decisions in terms of how aware we are of the fact that we're making a decision. Often we're not, and how intentional we are about making that decision. And my argument is that when you're really aware of what the decision is, what you're deciding, and you're very intentional about how you're making it, you're probably going to make pretty good decisions, quality decisions. And I say quality decisions here because a good decision, typically we think of as something that the outcome was good. A quality decision, the outcome might not be good, but you did everything right. You don't regret the decision that you made. So to make a quality decision, you need to be aware that a decision is happening, and you need to be intentional about how you make that decision. Just to kind of give some examples of each of these quadrants, a lot of our decisions are blind decisions. We're not aware that we're making a decision or what's really going on. We're moving through life buffeted by chance and genetics and everything else, like Robert Sapolsky would argue. And some examples of that are, most of you probably put your seatbelts on this morning, and I don't think you made the decision like, today I'm gonna be safe while I drive. I think you just did it because it's a habit. Often you cross the road to avoid certain people, or you connect really well with other certain people just due to stereotypes. These are those heuristics or mental shortcuts. Not necessarily bad or good, but becoming more aware of this could make you a better person. And then they have luck decisions. And we think about this a lot, particularly in traveling in avalanche terrain. We call it non-event feedback. Often nothing bad happens. So we say, oh, great. Like I made great decisions. And that's not really true. Sometimes you just got lucky. Often we ski a slope and it doesn't slide. And so we say that we did a good job, but we really didn't. Perhaps a friend 6 or 7 years ago said, hey, I got a Tesla and it's really cool. You should invest in their stock. And without researching the company or what they do or anything like that, you put a bunch of money in Tesla and it was a great decision. And you pat yourself on your back saying, I'm a good decision maker. But really, you just got lucky. You had good information and you made a decision on that good information. But if you'd had bad information, you might have made a bad decision or not really known that you had bad information. Poor quality decisions, I make these a lot, unfortunately, so I'm quite experienced in how not to do this. Often there's an ineffective framework. You're missing important alternatives that you could have used that would have made your decision easier or the outcome better. You're needlessly limiting your information. Or you're taking a lot of time or a little bit of time. You should have taken more time. Your timing is a little bit off. And I've got a bunch of examples here. Attention limited decisions. Maybe you're climbing a rock climb and you're so zoned into, I have to make this move work that you don't notice that there are three other options that you could use. So you decide to keep doing the same thing. You're in either or dilemmas at work. And anytime you have either or, you're probably missing some alternatives. There are probably other things you could do. Maybe if you negotiate at work for whatever it is, maybe it's for a raise or a pivot, you tend to compromise instead of collaborate. There's an amazing story of two companies who are negotiating over oranges and they negotiate the best compromise possible, but it comes out later that one company uses the peels to make zest spices and the other company juices the oranges. And if they had known that, if they had collaborated, for a third option, then both companies would have had less investment and gotten more out of it. There's sometimes noisy decisions. There's just a lot of competing priorities, a lot of different things going on. Maybe you're emotionally tied up in, like for me, for instance, like having another kid is a really emotional decision. And there's a lot of noise around that that needs to be cut through. Sometimes you have stories that you're bound to, like I'm good at this, or I'm not good at this, or I could never do that, or I should be able to do that, but I can't. Those stories limit our options and we make worse decisions. Sometimes we make purely rational decisions. You have a gut feeling when you're looking at taking a new job. I don't really know that I want to work for that person, but the money's better, the place is better, everything looks good on paper, the pros outweigh the cons, and then you get there and within a month, you just really dislike working in that environment because the culture is bad or the boss is bad. Not actually listening to your intuitions can be a problem. Sometimes just listening to your intuition can be a problem. You have a gut feeling that it's going to be an amazing job and you don't really think through all the pros and cons and you end up in Chicago in October and 2 months later you really regret it because you don't like winter and you didn't think about what the weather would be like when you took that job. And misusing time. Sometimes we spend so much time on inconsequential decisions like, should I get the chicken or the steak at dinner? Should we watch this movie or that movie? Should we start work at 7:15 or 7:30? Doesn't matter, just flip a coin. And sometimes we don't spend enough time on really consequential decisions. We don't get input from our whole team. So a quality decision is really just the opposite of those things. Having an effective framework, and I'd argue having those three questions that I'm pushing you to formulate in your mind to write down today is a good beginning for that. Considering seeking out alternative solutions, alternative options, alternative beliefs, having that critical thinking to think through the information that you have, having the right amount of information. Sometimes just saying like, I want a little bit more information on this can be very helpful. And doing it in the right amount of time, I think, leads to a quality decision. So back to this, I'll give you a second to start thinking about those three questions. And after I share a bunch of tips, I'll share my three questions and I'll ask you, hopefully some of you will share a couple of yours. I think it's helpful. And I think they all should be different. We all just think differently. So some tips that I'm gonna go through, I'm gonna just go through these one by one. There are a million different ways to make better decisions. These are just eight or nine that I've found very useful over the years. I think, like I said in the beginning, pick one or two that you want to start using as a tool to make better decisions. So first, we talk about heuristics, and I think a value-based heuristic, you could call a principle. And these are things that you should do some work if you haven't on what are your core values. That's something we spend hours and hours with clients working through, both in an individual, what's my core value, and a team, or what are our core values as a team. And understanding that can then lead to some principles. And that might be always help a friend when they need it, or don't take too much time, move fast through my decisions and then make sure that I can reverse them. It could be always do the right thing, always take care of our customers. Having those principles can help you make consistent decisions over time. I love this one. I've done a lot of expeditions with National Outdoor Leadership School, and every time there's a leader of the day, and that person is kind of in charge of how you navigate through the wilderness, and often we're not even on trail. So it's pretty challenging. And people will just get this analysis paralysis where they are so afraid to decide at a fork in the trail or to go this way or that way. They're so afraid because maybe they look dumb or it's harder for the group to backtrack or whatever it is. And typically I'm sitting there thinking, well, if you went 100 yards further, you'd have way better information. Like if you went to the edge of that cliff, you could look down and say like, yes, we can go down this way, or no, this doesn't go at all. And so I like to think about Jeff Bezos as one of his rules from Amazon of considering one-way or two-way doors. And decisions are typically always either a two-way door where you can make the decision, and if the things don't turn out the way that you thought they would, you can reverse it. It's fine. And I think as a leader, articulate that, like, hey, I'm making this decision. Here's what I'm looking for. And if I see these things, we're going to keep going. But if I don't see these things, we're going to revisit this decision. It's no big deal. It takes a lot of pressure off. And then there are one-way doors, like having another kid. That's a one-way door. You can't reverse that. Making sure that you understand which kind of decision you're making. And then if it's a two-way door, like poke your head in, see what it's like, go the extra 100 yards. If it's a one-way door, make sure that you're pretty darn right. Like if you're investing millions of dollars in some solution for your business, spend the time to do due diligence. This one's also really helpful. It comes from Annie Duke. She uses the example of you have a vacation and you're either going to go to Paris or Rome. And I think most of us here could really deliberate on that for a long time. Like, oh my goodness, what if I go to Paris and it's not as good as Rome? Or what am I to miss out in Rome? And you can spend hours and hours researching both locations and costs and everything else. They're equally good options. And sometimes you have equally bad options. But when you have equally good or bad options to make decisions on, a test that you can use is to say, if option A were not an option, would option B be okay? So if you could only go to Rome, would that be okay? Yeah, most of us say like, yeah, Rome sounds great. And if that's the case, flip a coin. It will save you so much time when you have these equally good or bad options. So just flip a coin and move on. Colin Powell said, you should make a decision with 40 to 70% of the information that you wish you had. That really freed me up because I was sitting at like 95, right? I want to know all the different information. It takes a long time to gather that information and to parse through it. And these days you're bombarded by information and half of it's false. And so if you say like, when I have 40% of the information, I'm going to make a move. I'm going to have a bias for action. You start to move a little bit faster. And John Boyd, he's a colonel in the Air Force, one of the best fighter pilots that the Air Force has ever had. I think he never got shot down in training, notionally. he came up with this thing called the OODA loop. And you can see some of the sketches here in this picture. It's a pretty complex philosophical idea. He was a strategic thinker, but it boils down to observe, orient, decide, act. And what he found was in a dogfight or in building strategy for a corporation, whatever the decision-making process is, when you're competing against other decision makers, if you can observe what's going on, orient yourself to what's going on, say, okay, this is what that means for me, make a decision and act faster than the other person, than your opponent, jet pilot, or whatever it is, then the other person will be stuck observing and orienting to you. Because you, every time you make a decision, you change the environment and they have to reobserve and reorient. So especially in competitive decision-making environments, consider that OODA loop. Like, can I make these decisions a little bit faster? Can I get better at orienting myself to what's going on around me and drive the process? And I think it's funny, like Marines, my wife was a Marine before she went to medical school, always say like, you're getting in my OODA loop. And that's what they mean. You're cutting them off at the observe orient. So they have to keep looping those two while you're deciding and acting and ultimately winning your dogfight or your corporate strategy. Pre and post-mortems are these kind of obvious but really powerful tools. So I'll start with the post-mortem. You can call these a debrief or after-action review, whatever you want. Some tools that Annie Duke shares that I think are really useful. When you make a decision, ask yourself, am I happy with the outcome? Am I happy with the decision? Was it the right decision with the information I had? And then what information did I have? What information do I wish I had had? And could I have gotten that information? And that'll start building this muscle for you of looking for the right information and getting the right information faster and cutting away all the other information that doesn't matter. Because really, like I said a while ago, if you had the right information, decision-making wouldn't be that hard. If you knew exactly the outcome of your two options or three or five or whatever options, then it'd be pretty easy to make a choice. Pre-mortems seem so obvious, and yet every time I don't use them, I really regret it. And in a great example, last year, we had a group that were gonna go backcountry skiing with us in Mammoth, and over the course of 3 days, a nice snowstorm turned into a blizzard. And long, long time ago, I had chosen to get a hotel room in Bishop, which is an hour south of Mammoth and a couple thousand feet lower, and way, way cheaper. So I was thinking, oh, I'm gonna save some money. I'm gonna get a room in Bishop. It'll be fine. We'll drive up in the morning. We'll get out there with our clients and snow camp and backcountry ski, and it's gonna be fun. But the situation changed. And this giant storm hit us, like 4 feet of snow, 50 mile an hour winds. And we decided, like, we're not going to snow camp. That's not safe. We got a cabin. Our clients drove up the hill and stayed in the cabin. And we got snowed out. We were stuck in Bishop because I decided to get a hotel room there to save money. And if we had used a pre-mortem, we could have avoided that. And what a pre-mortem is basically just thinking, what is the worst possible outcome in this situation? Getting stranded in a town an hour away from your clients is a pretty bad outcome. And frankly, pretty likely when a blizzard is coming, and one that if we had said that out loud, like, hey, what if we got stranded down here? I would have thrown in the extra couple hundred dollars to get a room up in Mammoth, no problem. So with your team, by yourself, however you're doing this, think about, like, what are three like really bad outcomes that could happen? And sometimes those will pare away options that you thought were good options, but actually aren't, or they will help you find alternatives that will make your decision better. I love this one. It's also pretty simple. And I have this book called You're Not So Smart. And it's about heuristics and biases. And yeah, sometimes we're not that smart, frankly, but we're also a lot smarter than we give ourselves credit for. And this is the point that Annie Duke makes. Like, if I ask you to estimate how much my dog weighs, most of you would probably say like between 25 and 50 pounds. And that's pretty darn accurate. You wouldn't say 1,000 pounds. You wouldn't say 2 pounds. We as human beings are able to bracket reality, bracket truth really well. And we can do the same thing with probabilities. And when you start thinking about all the different options on the table when you're trying to make a decision, when you list out the pros and cons of making a pivot in your career, you can assign probabilities. You can say, well, I like the 25% of the time I like my current job, and there's a 50-50% chance that I'm going to like my new job. An example, maybe you just really don't like your job, like 0% like your job, and there's a 70% chance that you'll really like your new job. Why are you still on that job? Like, the probabilities make it really clear that you should go to the new job. So thinking about your pros and cons list, what's the probability of this happening? 5%, 90%, 30, 70, whatever it is, can really bring more clarity to your decision-making process. This is a great one, and Annie Duke uses the example of, I think, Pete Carroll and the Seahawks making a play call in the Super Bowl that didn't go well. They threw the ball, it was intercepted, and everybody said, what a terrible decision, what a terrible coach. And what they're doing is resulting. So when we result, we look at the results of our decision and we judge the quality of our decision on those results. People were judging Pete Carroll's decision on the results, which were bad. But if you objectively look at the data, at how the opposing team had lined up, at the history of the Seahawks that season, his call was great. It was the right call. It just resulted in a bad result. And often, this has been a great tool for me, or at least makes me feel better when I make decisions and I think through, like, if that had been a good result, would I have been happy with the decision? Like, yeah, I would have been happy with it. Helps me to winnow out, like, okay, that was a good decision. Or, you know, if this is now a bad decision because the results are bad, maybe it was a bad decision. I can go back to that postmortem and start thinking about, well, what would I do differently? What information do I wish that I had had? This is actually the topic that I first spoke on, human factors in decision making. It turns out that most people who die in avalanches have a lot of experience traveling in avalanche terrain and know the science behind snow and how avalanches happen. And we still make really bad decisions due to human factors. Things like, we're committed to get to the top, or we don't want people to not like us because we're the person that says, hey, that doesn't seem safe, can we talk about it? Or expert halo, where I assume because you're loud and confident in what you're saying, you must know what you're talking about. Or because you're a doctor and you have expertise in one domain, you must have expertise in avalanche travel as well. We have all these insane things that happen in our brains that lead us to really bad outcomes, particularly when we're in avalanche terrain, but really just in life in general. Like, think about a business meeting where you were making a hard decision. There was groupthink. People were committed to different options and fighting for their options instead of listening to what other people. People were not speaking up because there wasn't enough psychological safety, or because the leader had said, this is what I think, before anyone else spoke. We have all these things that go on that lead us the wrong direction. But, comma, and our intuition is powerful if it is founded. And the example I like to give here is, if I went out backcountry skiing with someone and they said, you know, they've never been skiing in the backcountry before, I have no education or training in avalanche safety, and they said, like, oh, I'm kind of uncomfortable about this slope, I would listen. I think that's just a good practice at baseline. And I would ask them about it, but I wouldn't put a lot of weight on that intuition. It's probably driven by fear or just unfamiliarity in that terrain. Now, if I did all of the tests and everything showed that, hey, this slope is safe to ski, but a backcountry skiing guide who had been guiding on those mountains for 10 years said, yeah, but it just doesn't feel right, no way would I ski that slope, because that is a founded intuition. That person has spent the time and developed the expertise and seen different options play out over and over and over and over again. And what happens is we store all of this in our unconscious memory. So maybe that guide saw the snow crack in a funny way that he'd seen before an avalanche 7 years ago, or maybe he had been with a group that made a bad decision because of human factors, and he's feeling that kind of vibe with this group. And that intuition, like, there's no data, there's no, well, here's exactly why I'm saying that we shouldn't ski this slope, but the intuition is founded on those things that are stored in subconscious memory and ought to be listened to. So when people bring up things like that, discomfort in a situation, or maybe we shouldn't ask, have you seen this before? Do you have expertise? Have you gotten experience? And ask why. Sometimes they say, well, because there's a giant avalanche that just went down over there and you just hadn't seen it. But ask and see if that intuition is founded. Okay, lots of tips there. I hope some of them resonate or useful with you. And we're gonna send this out later. Ali will send you the slides. So you can go back through and pick one or two that makes sense to you. Revisiting what's a quality decision. You have an effective framework. You're using some sort of intention to consistently make decisions. You seek out and consider a lot of alternatives. Like the more important the decision is, the more alternatives you should get. You have the right amount of accurate information. So this is a critical thinking, being able to validate the information that you have coming in, validate the sources, cross-reference, make sure that is accurate information and that it logically flows. It's not illogical the way that that valid information is put together. And you're using the right amount of time. You can ask yourself, like, is this a quick decision or is this a sleep on it decision or whatever kind of heuristic you want to use, but you use the right amount of time. For me, my three questions, and I'll share and I'll give you some time to think and hopefully share in the chat what your three questions are. I like to think, what is the decision? Often we try to make the decision without really knowing exactly what we're deciding between two things. At the foundation of it all, what am I deciding? And if you can narrow that down, often your choices become really clear and it's not actually a hard decision. For example, I had a really hard decision years ago. I had a leadership coach and I was deciding whether to go back into the Navy and fly for the special operations unit. It seemed really cool. I mean, you got to fly Navy SEALs around and do all kinds of super cool stuff at night on night vision goggles. And I was pretty excited about it, or not do that. And my coach said, well, okay, in 5 years, like if you decide to do that, what is life like? And I'm like, well, I'm away from my family a lot. I'm probably stressed out. I've got a lot going on. I haven't been able to build this business, Care and Leadership, the way that I wanted to. And then she said, well, if you don't do that, what is it like? I'm like, well, I'm with my family much more, which is very important to me. And I'm able to put the time and effort that I want to put into building this business that I'm really excited about. And that simple conversation, I was like, oh, I guess I'm not going to do that. That really hard decision that I deliberated about for months became really easy when I kind of narrowed down exactly what are the options. And then make it in the right amount of time. Figure out what time frame you need to do. So what is the decision? What do I wish I knew? That question seems really simple, but often when I ask myself, what do I wish I knew? All of a sudden I say, well, I wish I knew how this would play out, or I wish I knew what the probability of this happening is. I wish I knew how big the storm is gonna be. And when I say that, often that information is accessible. I can ask an expert, I can look up the weather on a couple of different sources and get really good information. And then I know what I wish I knew. Or if I say, I wish I knew this and I can't get that information, I don't spend a ton of time wishing that I could get the information. I can't get it. I can get that 40% of information that I'd want or need to make the decision, like Colin Powell said, and move on. So what do I wish I knew right now? And then what options am I missing? And anytime I have a decision and I only have two options, I just make up a third. I ask around and say, like, what's another option to people that I trust and I think are smart? I find a way to get a third option, and that often breaks you out of that either or framework way that your mind's working. And often the third option, like sometimes it's a throwaway, it doesn't work at all, but it spurs some thinking and a fourth option comes up, and that's the one that makes the most sense. So my three questions: what's the actual decision I'm making? What information do I wish that I had that I don't have, and can I get it? And what is another option that I'm not thinking about? I'm gonna turn it over to you all. I'd love to hear a couple questions. Maybe like, those are awesome questions tonight. That's cool, I'll take that. But maybe you have a different question that you already use or after having listened through this, a different question that you'd like to use. So throw that in the question box, and Hallie, I'd love to hear what you see there.
Great. Thank you so much, Knight. We did have a question about the three questions, so thank you for explaining that, and I'll give people some time to answer, because there are a few other kind of thoughts and responses in the box that I'm going to read out.
Yeah.
So someone wrote in and said, I was just reading the fable of the centipede dilemma. The conclusion is that overthinking is holding us back from building the life we want. When you think every decision has to be perfect, you become afraid to move. One powerful realization for life is that decisions are generally reversible, but inaction is not. It's just a comment there.
Yeah, love it.
And that actually kind of goes into the next question, which is a good one. And someone wrote it and said they've had several bosses in the corporate world who did not make decisions, which in itself is a decision. What is your advice if your boss doesn't make decisions?
Yeah, I love that. So first, I want to the indecision or inaction. The Marine Corps says, like, no decision is a decision. I think that's so accurate. Sometimes, and I think if you're making no decision for the right reason, it's a good decision. Sometimes you just need a little more data. You need to walk the extra 100 yards to get a little more information. If it's based on that needing information, and you can probably see this with that individual, your boss, whoever is making the decision, like, ask them, like, well, what information do we need to make this decision? And they might say, oh, I'm waiting to see what happens in the Asia market tomorrow when the market opens, or whatever it is. And often bosses are afraid of making decisions because it makes us look dumb when it doesn't turn out well. So give them this slide deck so they can see that sometimes the results aren't linked to the qualities. No, I'm just kidding. But seriously, some education around decision can be really useful. It can free us up, make us not feel like we are either good or bad leaders because of the decisions we make. Sometimes just asking can be really helpful. Like, hey, boss, I need to move forward on this. Like, this is the direction that you've given me, but I don't have a clear decision on this. And you do the hard work of kind of the questions I'm asking. Like, what exactly is the information? And, you know, here's the information I have. Here's what I'm not sure. And I think maybe you have this information because you have a higher level in the organization, like you have more access to information, and that can help. And sometimes bosses are just, like, there's just a lot of insecurity. Like, a lot of you on here, like me, have led small and large teams, and it just feels crushingly hard to make a decision and stick to it. As simple as, where do you go for dinner for your team offsite? Because you're like, gosh, if the chicken's dry, everybody's gonna blame me. And I think giving some grace to the boss to understand, like, yeah, it's hard to be the one who has to make all the decisions. And, like, if your boss's inability to make decisions, he or she's not waiting for information, holds you back in your career, you got to talk to someone and figure out how to either coach your boss through it or move somewhere else, because that's probably not going to change if you can't coach them through it.
Thanks, Knight. Someone else wrote in response to your prompt about questions. One, what decision can I make with 85% accuracy, especially if I can reverse the negative effects? And two, what is the cost of inaction?
Yeah, I love it. And often inaction, I'm an inaction kind of guy. And I say that sort of facetiously, but a lot of times things aren't so serious as they seem. And problems just go away. You just take another day, sleep on it, another option comes up, more information comes in, and it goes away. So I think sometimes inaction is right if it's informed and you're doing it intentionally. That's where that awareness and intention piece kind of come in.
They actually added a third question. Three, what's in my control and what isn't?
Yeah, great question. And that, maybe we'll do stoicism for the next one of these. That is stoicism in a nutshell. Like, some things you control and some things you can't. Don't spend a lot of time fretting about the things you can't control. It's great question.
That's it for now, unless anyone else is in the midst of typing and submitting their question.
Awesome. Well, I'm going to just plug this stuff and then I'm going to open it up for questions. And this will come in your email, so just look out for it there. But we have a leadership summit. It's going to be awesome. We're going to climb a mountain and talk about the science of building high-performing teams. So you can use this Spring 30 code for a 30% discount for coming today. Hope I see some of you signed up for that. And then we send out resource lists every month. So you'll get the link for this in the email as well. But if this is stuff that's interesting to you, if having different books and different ways of thinking about systems thinking and decision-making and communication and culture or whatever, like we send out a whole list every month. I'd love for you to sign up for our trail log. That's what we call our newsletter, and get those resources because we have a lot of fun putting them together. And that's all I have today, but I'm super happy to answer any questions you all have or, you know, chat about different ways that you can use this material.
Thank you so much, Knight. I'll give it just a few minutes here to see if anyone types in questions, but of course, if you think of any after the fact, Knight's contact information will be included in our follow-up email, like you said. So definitely don't shy away from reaching out.
Yeah, definitely.
A few people have written in saying thank you so much and that this was helpful. So
yeah, glad to hear it. Thank you for coming. It's always more time on the computer. I appreciate you all.
All right, let's see. So we had someone write in. How do you think about long-term decisions, especially with going about a 10-year plan? Oftentimes it feels a bit difficult to think so far ahead.
Wow, yeah. And today, I mean, AI, 10 years, it's going to be radically different. So maybe 10 years isn't the right horizon anymore. We all talk about 10-year visions and plans. I think it's good to have one, but loosely hold it. And maybe focus more on the next year and what information we actually can have, and maybe have a couple co-ops. You know, if AI takes over the world, here's what I think 10 years is going to look like. If, you know, we figure it all out and things look a lot better and the economy's strong, here's where I want the business to be. And having those different courses of action can be really useful. But yeah, 10 years is just really, really hard. And I think what you can do, you know, you have more clarity around maybe a year horizon, and it gets less and less as you get to 10. And so you can kind of put a pin in the paper, your strategy or where you want to go, your vision, I guess is the right word, your vision, like this is where I want to be personally and in this type of career, and make it a little bit vague. Like I want to be doing work that I'm excited about and getting paid roughly this much and living roughly in this geographical area, and then back it up. Okay, if I want that vision to come true roughly, what do I need to do this year to make sure that I'm on track for that? And then be open to either subtle shifts in that vision or radical changes, depending on what happens. Don't do anything this year that you're gonna regret in 10 years. And keep moving kind of toward your 10-year vision. And I think that for me helps and works, but really tough these days. There's not a lot of clarity on what, you know, 2034 is going to look like.
Thanks, Knight. I think that's it for now. So I just want to take time to say thank you so much for coming on today and sharing your insight and expertise with our alumni community. And to everyone on the line today, thank you all for joining. Please look out for our follow-up email, which will include Knight's contact information, the slide deck and recording of today's session, and a calendar of upcoming programs. Thanks again for joining everyone in Hoya Saxa.
Thank you all.